win the support of CEOs, Harris jettisoned a strong argument that deflected attention from one of her weakest issues. Instead, the campaign elevated Mark Cuban, the very sort of rich guy that she had recently been attacked.
I wanted to just say that for the libs, for the liberals, for Democrats out there, you cannot blame unions and working people for this loss. You just can't do it. You can't do it. We read Bernie's statement earlier in the program where, in short, he said it should come as no great surprise that a Democratic Party which has abandoned working class people would find that the working class has abandoned them. And so basically saying that the Democratic Party needs to do more for working people to get the support of working people. Some people don't like that. This is Jamie Harrison, chair of the DNC, saying this is just straight up bullcrap. Biden was the most pro-worker president of my lifetime, saved union pensions, created millions of good-paying jobs, and even marched in a picket line. And some of the VP's plans would have fundamentally transformed the quality of life and closed the racial wealth gap for working people across the country. From the child tax credits to $25,000 down payment for a house to Medicare covering the cost of senior health care in their homes, there are a lot of great post-election takes, and this ain't one. Those things would be good if she talked about them, right? Those were part of her agenda, ostensibly, but she stopped talking about them. And just to illustrate that point, let's play this clip from of Ryan Grimm from Dropsite News on Al Jazeera about the strategy of the campaign. Let's listen to this.
Ryan, Harris had a different timetable than most nominees. Mm. She had basically 3 months to campaign after Biden dropped out of the race or stepped out of the race in July. Did she do enough to distinguish herself?
Clearly not. Democrats chose the one person who had the hardest time distancing herself from the number one because she was the number two. That was a choice. Like, right. They chose her. Once they chose her, Biden even told her and said publicly, I understand that she's going to be critical at times of what we did, and she's going to present her own path forward. She decided not to do it. One of the things that people were so frustrated about when it came to the 2021 price hikes was the price of Ubers and Lyfts. Yeah. It takes a chunk out of people. The only thing she could do is go after corporate greed. She starts doing that. Then she is told by Tony West, her brother-in-law, not to do that anymore. Tony West is the top lawyer for Uber. It's absurd. Yeah. And that's the Democratic Party. And they set themselves up to fail. I'm even wondering, when Tony West went into the ballot, did he even vote for her?
Oh, wow.
Now, he probably did, because he'd like to see her in the White House, because then he's in the Oval Office all the time. But he was actively sabotaging her campaign, whether he knew it or not. And the problem with Democrats is that they have those people in their inner circle, and they listen to them. The only way that she could argue that she was going to do something different than Biden was that she was going to go after corporate greed and get prices down. She started doing it, and then stopped.
Or Gaza, or, I mean, there
she could do that, too.
There are several issues that she could.
Like, what else could I separate myself on? Well, is there anything where his approval rating is like 20? Like, oh, yeah, his handling of Israel-Palestine, Gaza.
Right, I mean, it seemed like
can't do that.
Right.
So there you go. You know, you see, if you follow kind of the trajectory of the campaign, she started out with a higher polling more highly when she was talking about some of these economic plans that were officially on her, that were officially part of, you know, the campaign. But she stopped talking about him on behalf of, you know, these on behalf of people who work for Uber. Like, not an Uber driver, an Uber executive. Zaid Jilani, who is a pundit, mentioned that Jamie Harrison also is a former lobbyist for the Podesta Group, who worked on behalf of arms companies, who has never held in his life a single elective office in government anywhere. And it's just like, that's so crazy that you can point to the things that she left on the floor in her campaign as she starts talking more about, like, how great Liz Cheney is. I mean, it just doesn't make any sense. James Sirwicki who is the author, who is an author, contributing editor for Fast Company and The Atlantic, and an editor at the Yale Review, says about Bernie's statement, "This is ridiculous. Biden was the most pro-labor president in 60 years. His stimulus plan was targeted to get people back to work. Working class people saw their real wages grow faster than any other group. Dems did not abandon the working class. The working class abandoned them." And you can say, you can say that there were improvements made for working people, particularly for union members, during the Biden administration, while also recognizing that nothing fundamentally changed, which was, if we care to remember, a Biden campaign promise to donors. Nothing will fundamentally change. And that happened. Nothing fundamentally changed.
Hey, 5 seconds. Just wanted to say that this is only possible because of our donors. If you want to see more of this, then consider donating yourself at tvlr.fm/donate.
And so, you know, when there are fundamental structure, fundamental problems in the American economy and nothing fundamentally changes, and you have this period of high inflation, what do you expect to happen? Another, you know, people were also attacking Painters Union president Jimmy Williams. This from a random Twitter user. "What a freaking cop out that got a lot of likes," which is why I'm it's not like just a 5-like thing. "What a freaking cop out. I hope Trump follows through and guts all unions." Ostensibly a liberal, remember. "This is on your blatant racism as well. Let's remember that union members are actually more likely to be people of color than the average public. You didn't want a woman. Well, enjoy what comes next. Hope you get your protesting megaphones ready. Your freaking unions failed the American working class. You deserve the next 4 years. Enjoy." That's crazy. The libs are like, their brains are broken. Some of them, obviously not all of them. I love some liberals, and many liberals love me. In fact, some people say that more liberals love me than they love anybody else. But, but man, some of them have got brain worms. This is from another one. This is George Eaton, a senior editor at the New Statesman. Again, this is another liberal kind of thing. Says that this is a good moment to revisit this essay on, quote, "the death of deliverism," studied by Starmer's team on why Biden's domestic record counted for little. Deliverism, let's remember, is the idea that if you deliver for a group, they will deliver for you. If you deliver for a group as a politician, they will deliver for you in terms of votes. And so there's this idea of deliverism. If we do good things for working people in unions, then working people in unions will support the Democratic Party. But it was not fundamental, and there were a lot of problems with it. David Dayen for the American Prospect responded to this article, saying that, "In the opening anecdote of this article about the death of deliverism, the authors are mystified by the lack of enthusiasm from working class parents for the monthly child tax credit checks passed in the American Rescue Plan. One person asked, what's the catch? Indeed, there was one. The credit expired within 6 months," right? "The cynical assumption that the monthly checks wouldn't last is an artifact of decades of Democrats failing to follow through on promises, and it turned out to be completely warranted. Polling at the time showed that voters who received the benefits were more likely to support the Democrats until the credit expired, when they shifted back to Republicans by 15 points. Yes, and this is continuing in the article, yes, you can thank Joe Manchin for that almost entirely, but the point is that it's not surprising that a temporary policy did not flip voters. And that temporary policy represented actually the temporary improvements that people got from the American Rescue Plan and things like this. The retrenchment of those benefits actually represent the biggest retrenchment of welfare benefits in the last like 40 years, right? So it's like, that's not actually, it seems to me, that surprising. This is another article from kind of analyzing, you know, why some people think that he lost the election. "While Harris was stuck defending the Biden economy and hobbled by lingering anger over inflation, attacking big business allowed her to go on the offense. Then quite suddenly, this strain of populism disappeared." This is from The Atlantic. "One Biden aide told me that Harris steered away from such hard-edged messaging at the urging of her brother-in-law, Tony West, Uber's chief legal advisor. To win the support of CEOs, Harris jettisoned a strong argument that deflected attention from one of her weakest issues. Instead, the campaign elevated Mark Cuban as one of its chief surrogates, the very sort of rich guy that she had recently been attacking. So, when this kind of stuff happens, it does not seem to me that surprising. In some of the things that, and we can also point to the exceptions to prove the rule. Chris DeLuzio in Pennsylvania won in Congress, way outpaced Harris, running on this big populist message. Sherrod Brown and Dan Osborne both lost, but they also ran 7 points ahead of Harris in their campaigns, even though they lost. If Harris had gotten 7 points more nationwide, this would have been the biggest Democratic sweep ever, right? Claudia Sheinbaum in Mexico, the new Mexican president from their socialist Morena party, won the election by higher margins than AMLO won in 2018, despite having been incumbents during this period of high inflation, because they did huge fundamental things for working class people. We're going to talk some more about Claudia Sheinbaum in the coming weeks as like lessons for Democrats. But yeah, so there you go. Wanted to make sure that we got to those because felt like it was important to push back on some of that kind of stuff. Crazy. I was fuming watching Twitter after the election.
You just saw a clip from the Valley Labor Report. We are live every Saturday morning from 9:30 a.m. till 12:30 p.m. And we pride ourselves on keeping all of our content free to everybody so that we can talk to as many working folks as possible. If you support the work that we're doing, you think that it's important, you think that it's good, then consider making a monthly contribution to the project, and you can do that on our website, tvlr.fm.